Let's dive into top story number 4, and that is related to gene editing. And for our listeners, for our investors out there, gene editing headlines likely have filled your news feeds over the past year, 2 years, some for good reasons, some for not so good reasons. But the promise and hype of gene editing, being able to actually go to the underlying cause of disease and correct it before the disease even starts, has been a huge opportunity. Obviously, a ton of investor enthusiasm. But what we saw in 2018 is that, like any other biopharmaceutical asset, there are going to be setbacks. Todd, we saw that here with gene editing.
Yeah, and I'd call it stutter steps. You know, I mean, there's 6,000 genetic diseases, and I think they affect about 350 million people worldwide. And a lot of those genetic diseases don't have any treatment options available. So the whole idea of being able to, you know, go in and delete a piece of DNA or insert a piece of DNA that can, you know, change the way that we're producing proteins to fix or address these genetic diseases is really exciting. But again, stutter steps in 2018. The first big, I guess, stumble for you know, CRISPR, which is one of the main approaches for gene editing that's gotten a lot of attention, happened in May when the FDA put a clinical trial, a hold actually, that delayed the start of a human clinical trial of Vertex and CRISPR Therapeutics' CRISPR gene editing approach in patients with sickle cell disease. So that happened in May. Then in August, some optimism got renewed because Vertex and CRISPR were allowed to start human trials for beta thalassemia, which was the first time the U.S. company won an okay to start in-human trials for that gene editing approach. Then the clinical trial got lifted up in October, again, adding a little bit more enthusiasm for it. And in November, Editas, which is a CRISPR Therapeutics competitor, that they actually won FDA approval to start their human trials for a rare genetic disease that involves the retina. So for CRISPR, it's been kind of like that, okay, we're taking some steps forward, we're taking some steps backward. We want to make sure we get everything correct because, you know, we want to make sure that we don't run the risk of having off-target gene editing happen, where basically you've got all these repeats of genetic sequences in the body. We want to make sure we're only getting the one we want to be edited. And so I think some caution is warranted. But yeah, it created some stutter steps for that approach.
Yeah, so you mentioned the off-target effects. Thinking about that, there are some studies that have been running that could indicate, of course, the increased risk of cancer associated with the CRISPR-Cas9 system. So something to watch. May not necessarily be a deal breaker, especially if it gets approved for many fatal diseases where there's a huge unmet need, but certainly puts a damper on just commercial viability if that is the case. Also, too, from a CRISPR perspective, there are studies that show actually our immune system may actually not work well with CRISPR. So there are some studies that said, hey, CRISPR may not work in some patients, and then even those that it does actually work may actually elicit a response stronger than is necessary. So there could be some safety effects. I think all in all, though, as we see these first human trials get up and running and we start to see and hear about their pathway to approval, you can expect the regulators will be all over these companies and you can expect getting through to approval will be scrutinized.
Yeah, and it's really early innings for the CRISPR-Cas9 style approach to gene editing. Not so much early innings for Sangamo's zinc finger nuclease approach, which has been, you know, studies been going on since early 2000s for that approach. Actually, in September, they were dealt a blow when they reported disappointing results for a gene editing approach targeting Hunter syndrome. So that actually also dampened some of the enthusiasm for gene editing. So for CRISPR-Cas9, yeah, kind of early innings, and who knows when we'll finally actually get some late stage trial to digest. Won't happen in 2019, though, that's for sure.
Yeah, I think the earliest we might start to see some data is maybe 2020 there, but certainly something to keep an eye on.